coming to my lecture recital this evening. Oops, sorry, got a little ahead of myself. In my research, I try to answer the seemingly simple question, what to play on a piano recital. This notion of balancing repertoire that would appeal to a wide audience and the soloist's own artistic inspirations has always been fascinating to me. My first recollection of going to a piano recital was at the University of Alberta in Edmonton, Canada, where I grew up. And it was pianist Robin Lupu playing an all-German program. Now, I was 11 years old, sitting in the audience thinking, why were the pieces so long, and why was I not allowed to clap in between the movements? As I got older and more familiar with the piano repertory, I began to realize just how much piano music is out there. From the Baroque era to the 21st century, pianists have access to tons of thousands of original and arranged works for the keyboard, yet less than one-tenth of them are still performed or are in the standard performance canon. From this, a question forms in my mind. Why are pianists limiting themselves to such narrow repertoire? Many noted pianists of the 20th and 21st century specialize in a certain composer or a certain style. Canadian pianist Angela Hewitt is considered to be a Bach expert, and pianist Richard Good, who played the inaugural concert here at the Newsworth Hall, is known for his recordings of the complete Beethoven sonatas. And of course, Radu Lupu is known for his interpretations of German Romantic literature. This is not to say that concert pianists are not playing other works. The typical tour of style program is so prevalent that within the last 100 years, the structure wavered little from the model that Franz Liszt and Clara Schumann set with their concerts. The art of recital programming is a never-ending journey and discovery of hidden gems. Many things go in and out of fashion, but the core composers and repertory played on piano recitals have remained the same. Concerts would usually start with a piece from the Baroque era, followed by something classical from German or Austrian composers, and then something romantic and ending with something contemporary. As pianist and musicologist Kenneth Hamilton noted, to ensure a good attendance, all tastes had to be catered for. While this has rung true for the past 170 years, it is the golden age of piano playing that continues to influence and captivate pianists and audiences alike. Most scholars date the golden age from about the turn of the 20th century to about 1960. Noted pianists of this era include Moritz Rosenthal, Joseph Hoffman, Ignacy Paderewski, and Sergei Rachmaninoff, some of whom I will be introducing later in this lecture. Their attractiveness came from performing single movements of sonatas and transcriptions of excerpts from operas, ballets, and symphonies. Golden Age pianists followed the traditions of Liszt and other 19th century piano virtuosos, putting together programs of carefully selected works to highlight not only their technique, but also to dazzle the audience. Many also played their own transcriptions, while others took more liberties with pieces and did not always follow what the composer notated in the music. This more whimsical approach to piano recital programming is rare on today's concert stage, and the faithfulness and attention to the written score has become epidemic in the academia. My research concentrated on iconic pianists from two eras, the Golden Age and the 21st century. Because of its prestigious position in the classical performance world, I focused on solo recitals performed only at Carnegie Hall. Since its doors opened in 1891, countless performances have been presented in the hall, and it is still considered one of the most sought-after venues for concert pianists. Alexis Weisenberg said, and Princess Don Juan, Rigoletto, and Norma. Other transcriptions of songs and arias gave way to original works by German, French, or Russian composers. Through the analysis of pianists and their repertoire from the Golden Age and modern day, I will demonstrate what has and has not changed in over a century of recital programming. The increasing specialization of one composer or style contributes to the mundane state of most modern day piano recitals. Now, in my document, I do go into depth about modern day composers and pianists, but today, during the lecture, because of time constraints, I will be focusing on more of the Golden Age and the evolution of the recital. The idea of a solo piano performance did not become the norm until the Romantic era. Franz Liszt completely changed the concert scene when he came up with his own monologue pianistique. And the term recital first appeared in an advertisement for Liszt's performance in London in the year 1840. In the 54 documented recitals Liszt gave between the years 1838 and 1848, he frequently performed works by Bach, Beethoven, and his contemporaries, a remarkable shift from the previous two generations of pianist composers. It was very common for performers to have joint recitals and concerts featuring a variety of genres, arias, solo compositions, and chamber music were all part of a conventional program. Now here is a program that was published in the London Times on January 22nd, 1790. Now I know you can't see it very clearly because it's not a very clear program to begin with, but I'm just going to point out some of the names and composers on here. So we have works by Clementi and Haydn for solo piano, and we also have some chamber music by Pleyel, and then the rest of them are transcriptions of symphonies for piano and also songs. Even the famous violinist Niccolo Paganini shared the stage with illustrious singers of the day. Here's a program of Signor Paganini. As you can see, his name is very big on the program, but then it's not his own. So he's not performing on his own. We have a Mozart symphony. We have Paganini's own concerto. We have Rossini's arias. And then we have some of the other things, various other chamber stuff on here too. And then let's look at one more. This is Franz Liszt's program. This is the Grand Concert, featuring Liszt, of course. But then also we have singers. We have Mr. Richardson as the celebrated flautist. And then down here, they're all singers. And so you can see the pieces, the titles in bold, are all solo piano stuff by Liszt. And then the rest of them are chamber music and voice ensemble works. Now, in the solo concert that Liszt did on June 9th, 1840, in the Hanover Square Rooms, in London, it's completely his works, his own transcriptions, original works, and then this is, again, this is the first time that the word recital appeared. So he played his own transcription of the Beethoven Pastoral Symphony, the Scherzo, Storm, and Finale movements, his transcriptions of Schubert songs, the Serenade and Ave Maria, the Hexameron, which is the Fantasia with variations on the air from E. Puritani. And then he ended the program with his Tarantella and the Grand Gala. transcriptions and original compositions. As you can see in this one, this is his own concert, dated 1846. Everything's by list, played by list. And then you can see here, he started with the William Tell Overture. Second one is from his second year of pilgrimage. And then a Schubert, the Fantasy in the Sea, which I think it's the Wanderer Fantasy. Two HA Special Pen, and ending with Liszt's own Norma transcription. He would also take requests from the public, improvising on the suggested melodies, and thus keeping within the trends and fashions of his time. Now, I just mentioned that Liszt did perform some Beethoven sonatas, especially the later ones, but even then he was aware of the venue in which he presented them. Regarded as the more severe of Liszt's repertoire, the sonatas would be played in a more metropolitan German or Austrian city, preferably with a large percentage of connoisseurs in the audience. His performance of Beethoven's Hammerklavier in 1836 was successful, but in a subsequent public concert in 1842, Liszt only played two out of the four movements. On the other hand, Clara Wieck's programming around the same time seems more traditional by comparison. She abandoned transcriptions, instead focusing on promoting works by her soon-to-be husband, Robert Schumann, and interpreting past German composers. Here's a concert program given by Clara on September 24th, 1836. And this has very typical programming of the early 19th century. So you can see here another orchestral overture, a voice quartet ensemble. Clara played this second and third movement of this, grand concerto. And if you notice on this program, Clara was a very prolific composer, as we all know, but there's nothing of hers. And this change of playing the whole sonata, like Liszt did, was not instantaneous. Now, Clara Schumann slowly incorporated the complete sonata of Beethoven's Appassionata in her program within the 1830s. You can see here, she only plays the finale of the sonata on this program. The last movement was tested first, probably due to the fast and virtuosic nature, and when that was met with favorable reviews, she added the second movement, and finally performing the whole sonata in 1837. This act of offering a complete multi-movement work with no breaks in between was considered very daring. Chopin even interspersed lighter pieces and trivial vocal works in between the movements of both of his piano concertos in 1830 at the Warsaw National Theater performances. Now here's a program of Clara Schumann dated 1862, and I know again it's really tiny, but here she is offering a complete sonata of Beethoven, and in this case it's the C major, the Waldstein Sonata. And if you go back, early constructing the composer's original intent became concerns for performers. Pianists started to concentrate on a certain style of playing or a certain composer. Their specialization influenced by developments in musicology and music theory. Monumentalizing composers and creating a standard canon are also contributing factors in both the mixed and the specialized recitals. Along with musicology, effort is put into finding the correct way of playing a composer's piece, as performance practice became more and more prevalent in the 20th century. Pianists started to present programs dominated by Austro-German composers. By Busoni's time in the early 20th century, it was considered a throwback to the past to give a recital of his own works, and that was in 1912. To fully understand the changing trajectory of the piano recital, one must look at the broader movement of the study of musical arts. Through the 18th and 19th century, musicologists showed continuous interest with the evolution of music history. Increasing sentiments of German nationalism fueled this fascination with Austro-German composers and made musicians reach far beyond the influences of Italian music all the way back to the ancient Greeks. Critics like Edward Hanslick believe that although Bach and Handel marked the beginning of music history, notice how recent he's reaching back, it really started with Mozart and reached its summit in Beethoven, Schumann, and Brahms. His study on aesthetics and writing about absolute music, however wise and dated, remain a valuable source even today. In the 19th century, music history became a discipline in Austro-German universities under the leadership of music historians such as Guido Adler. Adler, unlike Hanslick, specialized in composers of the first Viennese school, Haydn, Mozart, and Beethoven, only later in his career. He pioneered research on Renaissance sacred music and examined the relationship of music and society, taking an evolutionary approach to study the development of German music. Johann Sebastian Bach is another composer that rose to prominence during the Romantic era. The Bach revival that started with Mendelssohn in the mid-1800s continued well into the 1950s. Many societies form with the sole purpose of compiling and publishing complete editions of unabridged works of the composer. From the Bach Gesellschaft that came up with the BWB catalog numbers to the Neue Bach Ausgabe published by Berengart, this has become the standard for other musicologists in the early 20th century. A definite, complete version of a composer's work would be akin to installing an unearthed ancient artifact in a museum. Scholars in the late 20th and 21st century are branching out and studying a greater variety of composers and genres, but the idea with preserving musical monuments and determining the Urtext edition is still very influential in this field. William Weber believes that the modern day concerts form a specialized world with members that look to an intelligentsia of critics, master teachers, scholars, concert managers, and to a lesser degree, radio announcers on classical music stations. The specialists are influenced by the more traditional field of academia, and that in turn impacts the concert etiquette, and to a greater extent, the music being performed in the concert hall. Before the 20th century, the concert scene was very different. There were diverse social etiquettes and expectations for the aristocratic and bourgeois audience. People did not only go to see the show, they also went to be seen. Conversations were often carried out while performers were still on stage, and it was not uncommon for people to leave their seats and move around. In today's concerts, one is expected to sit through a whole piece quietly, withholding applause until the very end of the out in patrons' homes or instrument makers' halls were great for exposure, but again, the performer was not the main focus for the audience. Sir Charles Halley, a contemporary of Franz Liszt and a serious pianist, for he was the first one to perform all of Beethoven's sonatas in England, recounted an amusing incident in his autobiography. His friend remarked that he was glad that Halley did not play like Alexander Dreyschock, for the latter pianist plays so loud that he made it difficult for the ladies to talk. The best place for a pianist to explore a serious repertoire and build a reputation was at the most intimate setting, in the homes of musical connoisseurs. At salon concerts, a more daring and intellectual program could be performed, but as I mentioned earlier, it was still important to cater to all tastes to ensure a good attendance. The Golden Age was a period full of glitz, abandon, and bold, brilliant grand strokes. Greatly influenced by Franz Liszt and his contemporaries, the Greek tradition was described as being largely lost by Kenneth Hamilton, saying that audiences can only hope to be granted a shimmering glimpse of it, like Sir Galahad of the Holy Grail, from the awe-inspired performance by a dwindling handful of elderly pianists. Hamilton also remarked that this tradition that included Moritz Rosenthal, Sergei Rachmaninoff, and Joseph Hoffman always seemed to be on the edge of extinction. Vladimir Horowitz, being the last of the Romantic pianists, gave his last public concert on June 21st, 1987, in Hamburg. Contemporaries of Horowitz, like Shira Tchaikovsky or George Bellet, continued to play in the manner and present programs from the Golden Age, but they too were in their twilight years in the late 1980s. Now, I would like to play for you some selections from a typical Golden Age program. I would like to begin with Tausig's transcription of two Scarlatti sonatas. The Pastorale e Capriccio was not paired by Scarlatti because the first sonata set of these songs on their, in many of their programs. And this is the Venetian Bow Song in F sharp minor.
Thank you.
nicknamed Perpetuum Mobile.
Thank you. Thank you.
nostalgic part. This represents the nostalgic part of the Golden Age.
Thank you.
glimpse of the glamour of the Golden Age. The nostalgia, accompanied with dazzling virtuosity and tuneful melodies, are what makes this era's music so approachable for the audience. By being overly intellectual in their choice of programs, musicians often close their minds to some charming and in many ways successful music. These wise words from Earl Wilde are ever important to today's artists. As a concert pianist, it is essential to keep the integrity of the composer intact, but it is also essential to have the imagination and charisma of the romantic pianists. The last piece I will perform is pretty self-explanatory. Liszt's Tarantella from his Venezia Napoli, second year.